May 16, 89, 90, May 14, 1990, 7:30 p.m., Peoples High School cafeteria. First order of business is a roll call by the town clerk.
Chairman Jordan.
Here.
Counselor Ambrose.
Here.
Counselor Hartzell.
Here.
Counselor Quinlan.
Here.
Counselor Torrey.
Here.
Counselor Masterson.
Here.
Counselor Barton.
Here.
All of business.
Thank you. Next will be the minutes of the meeting of 4-89-90, held April 9, 1990, and meeting of a special meeting 15-89-90, held May 2, 1990. You all receive a copy of the minutes, whether you wish it.
Chairman, I move to accept this.
Second.
Been moved and seconded, that we accept them as printed. All in favor, raise your hand. Opposed? The vote is unanimous. The next is citizen discussion of items not on the agenda. Any citizen that they'd like to say that doesn't pertain to the agenda? It's not, so we'll move on to the next item. Reports and correspondences. Anyone in the council here have any reports or correspondence? Councilor McGlaughlin.
Mr. Chairman, I wanted to report to the full council, knowing that everybody received a very nice graduation invitation for Buster's graduation. Buster is our police dog, and I was able to attend his graduation ceremony last Thursday, I believe it was. There were 8 dogs in the graduating class. Buster literally was top dog in the class, which is another nice award for Cape Elizabeth. I also wanted to congratulate Buster's handler, Officer Steindl, who was also top dog when he was graduating. And another thank you, I think, goes to Officer Steindl's wife, Cheryl, who had a pretty miserable experience with the first dog that was chosen for this role and is having a much nicer experience with Buster, as I expect we all will have. Thank you.
Well, she takes care of the dog. Anybody else got a comment? Councilor Emma.
I just want to alert the council to 2 upcoming dates. First of all, the COG General Assembly will be meeting on May 23rd. I believe Councilor Cotsall and Freeman will be attending that hopefully. Also, the COG annual meeting for local officials, that's the real fun evening. Our annual banquet will be held on June 21st, so I hope you'll all reserve that date. That's it.
Thank you. Anybody else? So we'll move on to item 174, to consider designating May 21st, May 25th, 1990 is Public Works Week in the town of Cape Elizabeth, and take any necessary action. Before we vote on that, I have a little duty to do. Thank you. Item 174, what you wish. Yes, Counselor Emerald.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we adopt the resolution as you read it and designate May 21st through May 25th, 1990, as Public Works Week, Cape Elizabeth.
Moved and seconded. Anybody else got a comment? Did I hear you say yes? All those in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed, it's a vote. The next order of business is a public hearing. 1991 School of Municipal County Municipal Services Budget. And I believe Chairman of the Budget Committee for the town is going to have a few comments, and then we'll open it up to the public. Counselor Cogshaw.
Thank you. I just want to basically introduce the municipal school budget. We have a proposed tax increase of 10.8% this year with a general budget of $13,692,201, revenues of $4,585,487, and net to taxation of $9,106,714. There is an increase of 3.3%, or 11 cents, on the municipal side. This results from a 7.4% increase in personnel costs, an increase in the rate hike from the Portland Water District on the hydrant rentals of $86,000, recycling and regional waste tipping fees of $43,000. The Cumberland County Commissioners also have levied a 36.4% increase in our share of the county expenses this next year. The school side income was reduced from expected school revenues from the state by 1.31%, but their budget has increased overall 12.2%. This is a result of salaries for teachers and administrators, as well as a need for a new portable classroom due to the increased enrollment at the elementary school. Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Now, before we open this up to the public, I have a couple of comments that I would like to make. The comments are, is some of the mail information that I have received, and I believe other councils received, kind of disturbed me, and I thought, okay, let's put a little bit of these tactics. I'll read just one part of this one. And I'm very disappointed that anybody would print this and pass it out, okay, let's put feeling that they're going to overpower the council, that maybe they have some Scrooges up here, or what, I don't know. After Loretta Pond makes her presentation and says, this is our final cut, $89,000. Everyone is requested to stand up and clap so loud, so long, that we want to hear the gavel call meeting to order. We are requested to bring kids, little ones, big ones, husbands, friends, and so forth. There are 16 kids in CE with no voting rights and no representation, so we are asking them to come. We want to overpower with respect. I don't think that's needed in Cape Elizabeth. It might be needed here, and the article is in the paper, but Dukakis loaded the audience or the public when they had the debate with Benson and Quay back in the election time. And here's an article that's in the paper the other day that I read. You might do those things then, but I don't think the people of Cape Elizabeth has to play that type of a role, as far as I'm concerned. I've had quite a few calls since our last meeting, and they've both been both ways, but I will say after the last meeting, the most calls I've got is for no double-digit increase. And how we're going to get there, I don't know, but... And I have a letter here and a petition with 10 signatures on it in support of the portable classrooms. And I just want to throw those things out, and we'll open it up to the public. And we'd like you to come to the podium, if you would. State your name so we can get your name down. And we recall all this to have in our minutes at our next meeting. So who would like to start? Right over here, the lady with the glasses. Maybe she could use that mic over there without her walking way across to the podium. We're always trying to be agreeable.
Thank you. I'm Sally Martin, and I have been asked by the Executive Board of the Cape Elizabeth Education Association to speak on behalf of the teachers of Cape Elizabeth. And I am doing this with a bit of reluctance because it's not possible for me to speak for all of the teachers. There are as many different opinions about the school budget and the budget process and the dilemma that we're in as there are teachers in Cape Elizabeth. So all I can do is to speak for myself and speak for as many of those teachers as I can. So please understand that this is not a unanimous voice. It's not even a clear majority voice. It's just the best voice that I have. I'm coming to you from a number of different viewpoints. I have taught for 27 years, 10th in Cape Elizabeth. I have two teenage children and one beyond, all three of whom have gone happily through the Cape Elizabeth schools. I am a taxpayer, and I am a sort of administrator in the sense that I'm the chairman of the English department here at the high school. So I look at the budget process with as much objectivity as I can, but this year I'm looking at it with a great deal of alarm, and I think so are all the teachers in Cape Elizabeth. And we're not coming to this meeting trying to whine because we're losing jobs or because we're not being appreciated. We are really concerned about the kids that we serve. And we just want to share that with you so that you'll know where we stand, and maybe you'll take that into consideration when you're thinking about this budget. When I came to Cape Elizabeth 11 years ago, Jane Amaral was on the school board. We did a lot of talking about excellence and how to improve education in Cape Elizabeth. And over the course of the last 10 years, I've seen a tremendous improvement. I've seen teachers working their tails off, if you'll excuse the expression, on curriculum committees. I've seen them genuinely dedicated to improving the writing process in Cape Elizabeth. I spent 5 years on a writing committee that was chaired by Bruce Thurlow, where we spent hours and hours trying to figure out how we could teach our kids to write better. And we are teaching our kids to write better. And one of the ways in which we are teaching them to write better is because we have more time, at least at the high school level, to spend with them. And so we can sit down one-on-one and we can talk with the kids about writing, and we can help them with their college essays. And we can do those things that Cape Elizabeth, in its excellent present state, has allowed us to do. This is a wonderful place to teach. This is a wonderful place for kids to go to school. This is one of the few communities of this demographic profile that I know where most of the kids stay here. They don't go to private school. They stay here, even if their parents can afford to send them to Exeter and Andover, they stay here because it's a wonderful school. And so the excellence of the entire school system is elevated all the time by the fact that we are a community which values education. And so the teachers are asking some pretty hard questions right now. And the hardest question that we're asking, and one that I have to share with you, is why are the cuts that are being made in the teachers and the programs who are on the front line with these kids? And why aren't the administration cuts of equal pain, shall we say? Why are there so many generals and fewer and fewer soldiers on the field? We're the ones who have to face these kids every day. We want to face them every day, and we're finding that there are fewer and fewer of us to do it. So all I can say to you is that we know that every person in this room, town council, school board, administrators, we all want the best for our kids. There isn't one single person in this room who wants to hurt the kids in Cape Elizabeth. There are no villains in this budget process, but there are many losers. There are very good teachers who are losers. I'm going on leave next year, and if I want to come back, there's no job. There is no job for me in Cape Elizabeth. Now, I could, by seniority, ask someone else to leave, but I wouldn't do that. But that's an irrelevant issue compared to the fact that next year we are not going to be able, the English department at the high school, to be able to offer the independent study possibilities that we have been able to offer this year. We're not going to be able to give the support that we can give to kids in all the writing activities that we'd like to. And other departments in the high school, and other departments in the middle school, and other places in the school system are having the same kinds of problems. And everybody's doing his best. The school board has worked very hard, I think, to try to make the cuts equitable and to try to do the best that they could. So I would like to suggest that maybe we need to be a little more aggressive and a little more creative as taxpayers in figuring out how we can get out of this dilemma. There are people at Cape Elizabeth who are fixed incomes, who don't have children in the schools, who can't afford to pay much more in taxes, and we've got to understand that, those of us who are in the schools. So maybe we need to think about such things as variable tax rates, user fees for extracurricular activities, user fees for the schools. Let's think creatively and not get angry at each other all the time. This is a wonderful place to live, and I think if all of us work together, we can make it, find a solution to this. The teachers want to do this. The teachers appreciate the pain that has gone on through this entire process. But we also want you to know how much we are alarmed about what might happen if we make any more cuts in the school side of the budget. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
With this awareness, I have begun really to scrutinize the offerings in terms of all the levels of the school system. And just this week, I've come to, via my sophomore daughter, I get a list of canceled courses in the high school. There are 20 courses that are canceled as of next year. I look at the list. None of this is fluff. They're basic high school courses. Nothing such as ethics, such as women's issues. None of this meaty stuff that really makes these kids grow and stretch. What it is Spanish, 5, economics, reading, verbal aptitude, advanced art, graphic design, music clubs. These are the things that will be gone next year. A lot of IA, which certainly is very important for a certain part of our education. I look at the middle school, and the proposal is to eliminate the industrial arts department, or offerings, and then also the home economics. So once again, these are courses that have always been the heart and the meat of a school system. There is nothing extra here, and these things are going to be eliminated. So, you know, I say, what is the best we're giving our kids? We ask them to grow, we ask them to stretch. We're not talking taxes here. We are talking about impacting our kids' lives. We are talking about honoring our teachers, many of whom who work really, really hard. So for me, the issue is the growth of our kids, giving them the best opportunities. And it comes through the wonderful thinking opportunities and performing. I want my kids to stretch and grow. And if everything is pared down to the basics, there's no opportunity for these kids. There's no extra mileage. And it makes me really sad. I think we render a tremendous disservice to our kids and also to the teachers in the middle school. Excuse me, this last week there was a medieval festival, a wonderful, wonderful happening for these kids. And they saw a great energy at a time, I'm sure, of tremendously low morale. They saw a great force on the part of the faculty and among themselves. And I think it was a wonderful opportunity for these kids to explore a time in history and to have fun doing it. These are the things that make us look good, that make us feel good about what's happening for our kids. And I'm worried about where it's going.
My name is Jack Lustig. Deference to the people that just spoke, who are worried about the education system and their children, all due respect to them. I am also worried. I'm looking at this town, and through this tax rate, which is double digit, I'm wondering how much of our school committee, how many of our teachers actually are looking at the real outside world of what is going on here in New England. We have a problem out there, and it seems that nobody here is willing to face the problem and do it in a good business type of atmosphere. We claim we are training our children for outside lives, the real world. Well, ladies and gentlemen, look at that real world out there. Look what's going on in Portland. Now, we cannot go on in this town with blinders on and continually think that what happens out there will not happen in Cape Elizabeth. I am also worried. I am worried about residents here. 3, 4, and 5 generations of families whose people are moving out because they can no longer afford to live in Cape Elizabeth. These people have given their sweat, their blood, their tears, and they're forced to move out. Is this justified? Could we classify this music program over and above some elderly people that just can't afford to pay taxes? After having paid taxes and worked in this community for probably 100 years, I really, really think a double-digit budget as we are coming up is basically almost an obscene gesture. And I plead with the council, and I plead with the school board, please readjust your thinking. I look at this school budget, and I cannot find anything in here that separates teachers from administrators. How much is our administrative budget? How many of our administrators, actually have hands-on education with these children? Are they sitting in ivory towers? Are we getting maximum productivity out of what we are putting into the school department? Has there ever been a survey made, an analysis of the productivity of our school department? How much waste is there? I call your attention, somebody alluded to some newspapers, which I dislike doing, but being it was brought up, let's look at the Portland paper this morning. National survey out of Washington, D.C., Dateline, Associated Press, said the urgency in our school and education system is not the meager budgets. That has nothing to do with it. The waste in administrative activities and the administrative part of our school department is solely to blame for the shortage of money within the school districts. And I plead with you, don't turn your backs on some of these people here. My greatest fear is turning this town into a one-class society, which we are fastly approaching. We are going to run this town with one earning level, one capacity, and that is really depriving your children of a good basic education to go to the outside world. It cannot go on this way. We have to show some fiscal responsibility. We cannot go on with a credit card type of budget. It just doesn't work. And I plead with the council and members of the school board, the teachers union, and everybody else, please use your judgment. If we turn this town into a one-class society, our expenses are really coming. Where is our volunteer fire department going to come from? Are we going to have to change that into a full-time fire department, our rescue unit, and everything else that the lower-income people within this town are supplying this town with? Then we are going to have a budget crunch. So, folks, I hope you all show your dissatisfaction with this blindfold type of budget that is being produced today, and ask them to please, please reconsider and do some real good planning to bring the budget down to where it should be. Thank you.
Chairman Jordan, town council members, members of the audience, I'd like to bring some points for the gentleman who just left and for the rest of the people in the room. And that is, we are eligible, if we are over the age of 65, for elderly tax credit relief. We have a state circuit breaker tax relief program, which will refund a portion of your taxes if your income is $60,000 or less. It is a sliding scale. The town of Cape Elizabeth currently offers exemptions to 387 disabled and non-disabled elderly veterans of World War I and World War II. 17% of Cape Elizabeth's population is over the age of 60. I don't have the demographics for over age 65. However, it is probable that less than 10% of our population is on fixed income. Cape Elizabeth students are 21% of the population. Their parents represent 35% of the population, for a combined total of 56% of our 9,000 people in this town. Of the 1,200 people in the town of Cape Elizabeth who work in Cape Elizabeth, 100 of those people work for the schools. In April, there were 1,573 students in Cape Elizabeth schools. That's 22 more than last year. The average cost on the state basis for a student in a school system is just under $5,000. If you multiply $5,000 times 22 students, you might see where some of the tax increase and budget increase, excuse me, has been requested. The 12th grade, which is the senior class graduating from Cape Elizabeth High School today, in June, is 127. The incoming class is 141. In Cape Elizabeth, we have made a commitment to quality education. Rural, community, open spaces, no commercial or industrial development. We have two choices for revenue. We can increase our tax rate and allow industry more development. Excuse me, I did that wrong. Our tax base by adding those things, or we can increase our tax rate. In Cape Elizabeth, there are just under 4,000 tax entities. Only 735 are taxed in excess of $200,000. 1,575 are taxed at under $100,000. Please do not just look at the tax rate when you consider the tax increase. Thank you.
My name is Ted Millett. I support the school portion, and I actually support the town budget as it was presented at the Finance Committee meeting on May 2nd. I believe that it is fair in several ways. The school portion is fair and in several ways inadequate in that it fails to address areas of concern that I have and that other people in this community have. It doesn't address alternative education for students who do not fit the traditional mold of college preparatory education. It does nothing to address dropout prevention. Whether you know it or not, there are people who do drop out of Cape Elizabeth High School. I have a daughter that did, and the school department not one time was concerned about why she dropped out. There was never an alternative put forth to her. I think that's a need in this community. I'm lucky that my daughter did well and got a GED and has full-time employment. I support, and I don't know whether this is the right time because I see it down the list, but I support the portable classroom and the funding mechanism that this community will use over the next 5 years. It will become a wash or we'll make a profit on it, small one at that. My reasons are simple. The elementary and middle school programs are two of this town's shining light. They are the beacons that attract many of the families here. We may see the already bulging school buildings increase with population over the next few years. But why do we attract these people? For the same reason I moved my family here and a number of other people moved their families here. It's an attitude that seems to exist in this community, that the young people are worth it. I became disillusioned with the community that I lived in and the attitude of cutting just to meet a certain arbitrary budget level that exists in some of our neighboring communities, and you can read it in the Portland Press Herald. We are in a community that answered in the affirmative by over 90% when asked if we would pay higher taxes to support schools. And this was your own survey. Don't forget that tonight. We are budgeting money to purchase land for a green belt in our community and to keep it for our kids' future, or their education is our future. We might better spend that money on our schools if an arbitrary 9.9% tax increase is held here tonight. But I want both. 10.8%, 9.9%, the difference is less than $65 on an average house in this town. Why not look at some innovative ways of raising money in this community, like charging the non-residents to use Fort Williams? We as taxpayers maintain that. The state charges us to get into our own state parks. Why can't we charge the people who come into our town and use our parks? I've learned a lot about this town and its schools and our representatives over the past month. At this point, I favor the passage of the budget without additional cuts on the town or the school portion of the budget. Thank you.
Council Chairman, members of the council, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Clint Fecto. I have been a resident of Cape Elizabeth for pretty 31 years. Second trip to a council meeting in 31 years. Usually you haven't paid too much attention to it. But I think what little I have to say probably won't have too much of an impact. Out of the audience, most of the people here who are parents, out knocking themselves out to make a living for their children, and are probably engrossed with those type of concerns. But I look at my own personal concern. I retired 22 months ago. I received a retirement fund from my company. I turned around and invested that in bonds that were paying fairly well at the time. But in 2 years, the bonds have dropped down 14.4%. And if I'm lucky and live another 10 years and look at a projection of about 7.2% a year, you know, that's a 70% drop. I don't think that's going to realistically happen. My Social Security in 2 years has gone up 4%, or roughly an average of 2% a year. And you know, if you were to project that 10 years down the road, and you say, well, what can I look for 10 years from now? Can I afford to live in Cape Elizabeth? What's going to happen to my standard of living? I think every parent should be concerned about the education of their children. I certainly were when I was bringing my children up here. I can remember about 20, 22, 23 years ago, I can't remember exactly where it was, but the people in Cape Elizabeth voted down a $1 million high school. And the at that time, there was an outside group brought in who were very professional in their work. And for about a year, they held a series of meetings throughout the different communities, houses on a house-to-house basis in Cape Elizabeth. And they did a great job of selling the people and voting in a $3.5 million school. But we went up $2.5 million in our school. And right after we got the school built, we were told we had too many classrooms. I'm sure Billy Jordan can remember that. He was here at the time. So after that, we tore down some school buildings that we had. Now we're told that we don't have enough school buildings, that we need more school buildings here in our town. I would say to every one of you here, I have basically ignored everything that has gone on as far as education because I wanted my kids to have a good education. But I would say this to you, the school system, the teachers, and the administration, and our children have been on the gravy train for the 31 years that I've lived in Cape Elizabeth. And I think we're going to have to take a look at reality. What's happening to the economy in New England. I would hope the day would come that I wouldn't have to move out of Cape Elizabeth because I couldn't afford to live here. And like this lady said, the other 10% of the people who are of retirement age. Well, I don't think that you want to live in a community that you're going to turn your back on these people and say, well, we don't want you to get the hell out of town because you can't afford to live here. So I think you have to face reality. You can't have everything you want for your children. I, unfortunately, have never able to afford it. I walk in life. And I don't think the average person can. I don't think the average person in Cape Elizabeth has everything they want in life. So I say, be realistic. When you start talking about a 10% increase in our budget, that's a healthy, healthy increase. And I think it's exorbitant. I think you have to be realistic. You know, I was listening to the gentleman talk about lack of concern for his daughter when she was dropping out of school. At the time, we were in between the $1 million and $3.5 million high school. I attended one of these meetings, and a very eloquent, prepared gentleman got up and spoke about what they wanted to do, and we absolutely had to have a $1 million swimming pool in our school system. And you know, I'd be willing to bet you that half of the people in Cape Elizabeth have property up at the lake somewhere, down in the ocean, but where if the kids really wanted to go swimming, they could do it. Plus the fact that the YMCA and the YWCA are important. We had to have a new theater that represented, I think, $500,000 in our new system. And a theater was good, there's nothing wrong with it. But for many years back then, our children put on some great programs and some great theater in the gymnasium we had in the junior, what is now the junior high school. So just think about some of these things that you talk about, getting the kids everything they want them to have. Sure, we like to give everything to them. That's a natural parental instinct. But I say to you this, that same meeting that I talked to, I said, look, let's improve our industrial arts program, because I had children from Cape Elizabeth working for me. They couldn't add and subtract and multiply and divide. And they had graduated from schools. And we had to put them out, give them diplomas just to Cape Elizabeth High School. Couldn't put them on a truck delivery because they couldn't do the arithmetic that was involved. I said, there are many girls in Cape Elizabeth who are not going to go to college. And I said, let's put that money into a very good secretarial program for them. And the guy said, you're against education. I said, no, I'm not against education, because I was going to be a school teacher back then. Paid $2,100 a year back, but I got to go to college and school. I said, make more money than that. So what I'm saying to you is, don't ignore the older people. Give some thought. Can you afford everything you want? Can our school system afford it? Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My name is Marvin Chagan. I've been a resident of Cape Elizabeth for 25 years, and my younger son graduated this high school and received a quality education. There's no question about it. This school develops quality students. However, some of them still show poor spelling, poor composition. We reach them and try to improve their graduating credentials. I have to respect the teachers and respect the school board for trying to develop a school budget to the best of their ability. No, not to the best of their ability, because their ability has clouded their ability to see the real world. Earlier speakers spoke to the fact that we must be realistic in any administrative capacity requesting funds from either taxpayers or users. We must be realistic. What is the public able to pay? And if they can't pay it, your product will not sell. And if we can't pay, your school is in trouble. And I claim that those figures, that there are 35% of the families in Cape Elizabeth have students in school. The other 45, 55, 65%, those are either senior citizens or families without children. Well, I can't condone supporting 35% of the taxpayers with additional taxes to the extent of $2 million increase for elementary school education. I feel that they have been clouded in their perspective and their vision of just what the real world is all about. Now, they will focus on courses canceled, teachers furloughed, teachers not allowed, not expected to come back. I think it's easy for the administrators to say, well, if you cut my budget, I'll let this one go, I'll let that one go, rather than doing something comprehensive, something innovative, that is enlarging classes to someone, or questioning whether we want to pay outside services, whether we want to pay for this, whether we want to pay for that. There must be a way of reducing the obscene increase in school budget. You were saying that the middle school will save you $600,000, but your elementary school will cost you an additional $2 million. Tell the elementary school administrators that they're limited to $600,000 as an increase rather than $2 million. And you immediately save $750,000 on your budget. Let them figure out where they are going to make it balance. In our federal government, they said Graham Rudman comes into effect if we don't trim the deficit. Well, this school system is proposing a deficit financing, and the deficit is to be paid for out of our pockets, and that's unreasonable. reasonable. I can see a 5% increase, a 6% increase, but I'm talking about an additional double whack, almost 11% increase. I don't think that's reasonable. I would recommend the town council defer the school budget and refer it back with a requested $750,000 reduction. Thank you.
Good evening. Same ballpark, different team. Mr. Chairman, members of the town council, my name is Vaughn Dyer. I'm a police officer for the town of Cape Elizabeth and the president of the Cape Elizabeth Police Patrolmen's Association. As the sole bargaining agent for the officers, supervisors, and dispatchers of the police department, the CEPPA has no affiliation with the Teamsters Union, AFSCME, or AFL-CIO. Rather, as an independent bargaining agent, we rely on direct, independent negotiations to assemble contract agreements, which we work under from year to year, and have shunned offers from them to enlist. We prefer to remain in an organization of professional police officers and dispatchers. At the unanimous direction of our membership, I have been asked to address you this evening regarding the financial inequities that we have seen become apparent throughout this budget process. On the one hand, we have witnessed one administrative body of this community, the Cape Elizabeth School Board, support and defend what many have regarded as unconscionable, generous pay raises for their teaching professionals. Indeed, increasing some teachers' salaries by more than $10,500 next fiscal year could be regarded as extravagant by some. But instead of denouncing these efforts, we applaud them. We applaud them because of the courage displayed by the members of the Cape Elizabeth School Board in amply rewarding their educators for their excellence and professionalism in the face of public questioning. It is not unlike that courage which we as police professionals must take on patrol every day. Some have pointed out the length of the school year and the amount of time off that these educators receive as motivation to inhibit their salaries, which they deserve. Well, those of us in public safety avoid this scrutiny. As when school closes in June, our busiest season is just beginning. When Thanksgiving break arrives, we split our shifts in an effort to salvage a few hours home for Thanksgiving dinner. And when Christmas vacation begins, we check the work schedule to learn if we're among the lucky few who get to spend the holiday with our families. Those of us who have planned a career with the police department will be working rotating shifts into our 60s, when we will be finally become eligible for retirement. Should a hurricane or other natural disaster strike, our families will be left at home to fend for themselves while we are called back to work to protect others. Teaching professionals attend years of college education to become qualified for their positions. Similarly, post-secondary degrees have become the standard for police professionals as well. But after receiving our educations, we must first prove ourselves by undergoing written examinations, oral interviews, psychological evaluations, drug screening, physical examination, background investigation, and polygraphs before even being considered for a position with the Cape Elizabeth Police Department. The quality of education at Cape Elizabeth has been rightly lauded as a means of attracting new taxpayers to the community. I'm here to tell you tonight that not a few prospective home buyers stop first at the public safety building to learn that our residents enjoy one of the lowest Part 1 crime rates in Cumberland County. Our school students' test scores demonstrate the high level of educational excellence to the citizens of Cape Elizabeth. Police services are held in similar regard. 2 years ago, a community-wide survey sent to every resident by the Cape Elizabeth Comprehensive Planning Commission indicated that 88% of the respondents ranked police services as good to excellent, bested only by parks and recreational facilities. This type of response to police services is unheard of in a profession where one's duty often requires imposing on the liberties of those that we serve. And during 1989, we performed those services with fewer than 3 sick days per officer, with no contract grievances, with no adverse publicity, with no civil liability actions, and with more
no more than $175 in workers' comp claims. Yet for the last few years, we have stood by and watched as the town's educators are paid at the top of the scale with little regard to comparable communities, while our pay is scrupulously judged against a narrow band of municipalities that have impressed this council as being similar to our own. Even then, as we cite the town of Scarborough, a community that you picked as comparison, the disparity in pay is shrugged off as some meaningless anomaly undeserving of your countenance. Recently, an Evening Express article cited the base weekly wages for a senior Cape Elizabeth police officer as being $65 higher than a neighboring Cape Elizabeth police officer of the same grade. As our membership learns of the continued inequities of this budget process, we can't help but ask the question, what are we doing wrong? For lack of an acceptable response, we have come to realize that we are being held hostage to arbitrary standards because our purse strings are controllable and subject to judgments and comparisons designed for the purpose of balancing misplaced perceptions of an overpriced educational system. Clearly, there are factions of municipal employees who, at the conclusion of this process, will be rewarded for superb performance by being paid in a manner consistent with their fine reputations and abilities. Through our continuing negotiations, the members of Cape Elizabeth Police Patrolmen's Association would ask to become part of this community-wide system of reward for excellence and professionalism. My appearance here tonight marks our association's initial attempt to publicly inform you and the community at large what we regard as an unfair and inequitable system of comparative worth. Our dreams, hopes, and needs for our families, futures, and educations are the same as yours. I want to be able to maintain a quality standard of living for my family as well, to provide little more than just the basics, to be able to send my children to the best college that their abilities allow, to be fortunate enough to allow them to fulfill their dreams. That my remarks may not be taken out of context and you may peruse them later, I would like to provide you each with a copy of the text. Thank you.
Chairman, members of the council, ladies and gentlemen, my remarks will be very short. My name is Howard Sayre. My wife and I built our first home in Cape Elizabeth in 1963. Somebody earlier, our first speaker, said Cape Elizabeth is a wonderful place to live, and that's exactly right. And we enjoyed the Cape Elizabeth, and we educated our son through the Cape schools. And he did very well, went on and got a master's degree from the University of Chicago with honors, and we're quite proud of him. But I think he'd be a little disappointed today if he knew mom and dad, pretty soon, because we're retired and on a fixed income, will no longer be able to live in this wonderful town that he grew up in and loved. A lot of people here are young people, parents, and you've got this to look ahead when you have a fixed income. And sometimes it's a little scary because we don't get a 10% increase in our salary. It stays the same. So my purpose of being here tonight is, again, the cry for those of us who are elderly and retired in this community facing a 10.8% increase in our budget. And it's pretty tough for any of us on a fixed income to look at that and swallow it, and to think that down the line, we won't be able to live in this wonderful town. And if we can't live in this wonderful town, our house goes up for sale, and a family comes in with three or four more children. And then what do you think happens to your school system? Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Frank Potenzo, council chairman, council residents. I've lived in Cape Elizabeth for 32 years. My wife and I raised three children and went through the school system. attended several meetings of the council, the school board, the school administration, and I've learned quite a bit. Not only from listening, but talking to some of the officials after the meeting. Here in Cape Elizabeth and throughout the world, there are basically three kinds of people. People who watch things happen, people who make things happen, and then there are people who wonder what happened. There are going to be a lot of people who are going to wonder what happened after the council makes a decision on this tax increase. Now, I came a few minutes late. The reason for it is that I was out securing some names of people who were not able to attend this meeting. And I have about 18 or 19 names of neighbors and friends that are urging the council to keep the tax increase below double-digit figures. Now, a lot of people have been talking emotionally about living in Cape Elizabeth and how good it is and the quality of education and the wonderful town and the wonderful people. But I haven't heard many talk about the real nitty-gritty of things. Some of the meetings I went to, one of the counselors asked the school superintendent how difficult it was, is it for a teacher to get on the career ladder? And I know it was instituted 1984-1985. Some teachers prior to that all on tenure, some refused to go on the ladder, and then some decided that that was the way to go. And I don't think the people that put this career ladder in effect at the time looked down the road too many years, because now the increments are so large that it's breaking the back of our tax system. That's only one thing. When there are 17 teachers going to share $184,000, 10, 12, $13,000 pay raises in 1 year is exorbitant. Our other town employees look at that. The morale's got to be very low. There's got to be a lot of jealousy. There's got to be a lot of frustration going on. I also heard at one of the meetings that the chief of police is 35th down the list in salary. I understand that the town council has proposed a 5% increase for municipal employees. School superintendent and his group put in for a 7% pay raise. Now, if you're looking realistically at things, why can't school administration come down 5%? There's a savings right there. I know people that are quite old in Cape Elizabeth and been around many years, and they told the powers to be way back, don't build the high school in this location because it's quicksand. It's going to sink, it's going to have cracks everywhere. They went ahead and built it, and now they have a lot of maintenance problems. It's too late now to undo it because it's here. Another meeting I attended, I was shocked at the applause and hooting that some of the school board members received after they spoke. And I didn't realize until afterwards that these people were coached to applaud. Now, I thought Cape Elizabeth was a beautiful town with friendly people all working together. When I got home that night in the evening paper, there was an article about the vice presidential debates between Benson of Texas and our present Quayle. And it came right out in print that the Democrats stacked the audience with instructions. Now, I don't think we need any of that in Cape Elizabeth. That's getting down to the nitty-gritty. This is not emotional. This is not pie in the sky. This is getting down to things. I asked several administrators of the town, who's running this town? Town council, the school board, or the school administration? And the answer I got was, that's a good question. I realized that the school teachers have a two-year contract and that the career ladder increases this year are in effect and there's nothing anybody can do about it. But I would like to see the increments in that career ladder lowered substantially to save this town some taxes. I'm all for quality education, but I don't believe it has to have a super duper price tag attached to it. There are a lot of things that can be done. Look what Scarborough did when they had a problem with the asbestos. They were ready to farm their kids out to Westbrook High School. What if lightning struck the middle school or all the pipes burst and for 4, 5, 6 months it couldn't be used? Would the school board request more portable classrooms, or should we utilize all the empty space in this high school? Another fact I picked up at one of these meetings, 425 students in the high school built for 1,000. School board refuses to move the eighth grade up. Segregate them in a few rooms so they don't have to mingle with the older kids. What's wrong with that? Why can't we do something to save a few dollars and still have quality education? And I don't think that the town council should have to have in front of them a scale and decide on a vote as to how many people call and say, I'm willing to pay more taxes for quality education versus the people that don't call. I think it's up to the town council to make the decision. They are elected people. We didn't trust them, we wouldn't elect them. They're there, they should make the decision. They should not be influenced by school board people, school teachers. And getting down to the nitty gritty, could I ask in this audience, how many in the audience are school teachers? Okay, how many of your school teachers live in Cape Elizabeth? Well, I just want to get down to some basic things.
And I think the people understand that there's residents and there's teachers and there's non-residents. And I think that
okay. Well, some of these things sometimes don't come out.
I understand. And
everyone. Meetings I've been to, the town council has kid gloves on, and the school board has kid gloves on, and they go round and round. Everyone's so polite to one another, and nothing seems to come out bottom line. I would like the town council to push for lower taxes below double digits. And my taxes, like all of yours, 32 years in Cape Elizabeth, have gone up 5 times. I'm not on the ocean, and some of those people, their taxes have gone up considerably more. And I still believe we can have quality education. Teachers are here to teach. Cape Elizabeth school system is not a honeypot that attracts teachers here solely because of quality education. They come here because they know Cape Elizabeth pays more than most other towns. There are only 4 towns in the whole state of Maine that have a career ladder. I think we should look at that very carefully, and I think there are other areas where cuts can be made without disturbing the quality of education. And I think a lot of people in the state of Maine are laughing at Cape Elizabeth when they know that there's 425 students in a high school built for 1,000, and we're purchasing portable classrooms. I think the space should be utilized somehow, even if it means a little extra effort or a change. Nobody likes to change. Nobody likes any hardships, but let's be realistic. Some of the other speakers have said, let's look at the world. Let's look at what's happening. Right now, there's four bankruptcies that are more than double this year than last year at the same time. People have to be realistic. I thank you very much.
My name is Debbie Butterworth, and I live at 21 Macaulay Road. I have three children in Cape Elizabeth schools and one toddler at home. I mustered up my courage to speak here today because what you are about to vote on will really affect me and the quality of education that we want for our children. Like many other families, we moved to this town 7 years ago solely for the outstanding school system. While I realize there are revisions that are necessary when preparing any budget, it seems as though everything is reduced to dollars and cents here, and I don't want anyone to lose sight of the fact that we're talking about real educational experiences and opportunities for our children. Do we want our children's education to be lacking the skills taught in any of the programs that are in danger of elimination? For the relatively small increase in taxes, I feel the impact on our children is too great to cut any further items from our budget. This is not the place to discuss the merit of specific items on the school budget. Rather, it is a time when parents, such as myself, can show our support for the decisions made by the school board in providing programs and opportunities for our children through their fiscal responsibility. I feel that the school board and the administrators have come to you honestly and sincerely with the lowest budget they, in all good conscience, can deliver. And I hope you can support their efforts with a vote to accept the school budget as they have presented it to you. Thank you.
My name is James Gerritsen, and I haven't planned to speak tonight. But I think what's happening here, we're almost having a competition, the young against the old, and I think that's very, very unfortunate in a community like this. I think it goes a little bit further, becomes town council against school board, and you get little groups, and the town council are doing the best job they can to control the spending, the tax rate. The school board are doing the exact same thing. They try and ensure a good education for our children. I came here 10, 11 years ago for the same thing. We want not only a good educational system, we want a good police force, we want a good town, we want a good community to live in and thrive. I would be very disappointed if I was up here tonight supporting the high quality of the existing school system. And come back after my children, I've got a lot of them, all graduated, and stood up here saying, wait a minute now, I don't have any kids in school, I don't support having a good school system anymore. And maybe that's what some of us are doing. The elderly, the people on fixed income, that is very, very difficult. The people who do have children in the school system, they're not necessarily any richer than a lot of the elderly people. It's very difficult these days throughout the whole population to pay bills and to pay taxes. However, in order for our children to have the quality to move on, to compete, particularly when they say how bad the economy is, our children have to compete in that bad economy. The only way we're going to do that is to prepare them as well as possible. We can slash the school budget overnight, get rid of all the good teachers. Hire teachers who are willing to work for under $20,000. I mean, quite honestly, that is one way of doing it. All your good teachers will then go to industry, and you'll be left with a very lukewarm system. And you have a lot of people leaving Cape Elizabeth.
I don't want my children to grow up in a lukewarm society. I don't want them to be trained in those programs only that's going to gear them towards Princeton either. I want to see an industrial arts program. I want to see a home economics program. I want to see challenge programs. I want to see creative artistic music programs to enrich these kids so they can be prepared to compete outside. It's getting tougher out there. Cutting the basic courses, cutting these enrichment programs, cutting the quality of their education is cutting their opportunities as they grow up. Don't make it young versus old. It's strictly we have a problem. The problem is not unique to Cape Elizabeth. The problem is the whole Northeast, every school system are having meetings every other night with the same problem, how to handle the budget, how to handle the cuts. Let's not just slash these creative programs. Let's maybe there are other ways we can do it. People who are on fixed income who cannot afford the taxes, people who are the elderly who cannot afford the taxes. Maybe we should look at these programs, these tax credits, where there are other opportunities. But if the school board really looked at all these cuts and found that these are the only places we can cut, then I would say we can't afford to cut them. They're inappropriate. They are a core of any school system. They are essential. We cannot cut any further than we've cut, if it's going to be as presented to the town. If there are other areas of cuts, let's look at them maybe later. But right now, we, in order to keep the school system intact so it doesn't get diluted and like any other low-level system and all our good teachers, our creative teachers are gone, you'll never get them back. So we have to maintain that. And I'm basically asking for the support to allow the school budget to go through without any additional cuts. Thank you.
Your recent decision to
fund the expanding enrollment in the middle school through the use of affordable classrooms. Given the time period for consideration of the issue, we agree that this was the least expensive and most efficacious alternate proposed. We would reiterate the position stated in our earlier communication that future decisions regarding enrollment changes need to be based on a comprehensive facility and curriculum plan. Such a plan needs to identify and evaluate all options from both a fiscal and program point of view. Without long-range planning, the school board, the town council, and the citizens of Cape Elizabeth will be forced into crisis decision-making each year. With regard to additional reductions in the proposed $8.9 million school budget, we urge the town council to approve the requested level. Significant reductions have already been made by the school board, and most of the remaining increases relate to funding for teacher salaries and costs associated with rising enrollments. Recognizing the fiscal limitations of the current year and the loss of state aid, we urge the town council to maintain the strong commitment to education that it has demonstrated in the past. Thank you.
Hi, my name is John Knight, and I'm in 8th grade. I came here because Mrs. Ellis, the middle school home ec teacher, asked our class to come down and help her. But looking around the crowd, I think I'm the only one that came. I was talking to somebody the other day in the school, and telling them I was going to come and help, and they said, "You're a kid, you don't know anything about taxes." And I said, "It does. That's why we come to school, to learn about this stuff." And he said, "Then you should go." So I came. And what I want to do when I grow up is I want to be a chef. And for one of the school programs, we went to career fairs talking about different things that you can be from people. And thanks to Mrs. Ellis and the career fairs, I got a job, summer job, at International Caterers because of this. And I wouldn't have gotten the job if I had to take the course with Mrs. Ellis, because she's been teaching me since 7th grade and this year to cook. And I think I'm the only one in 8th grade who wants to be a chef. But there are like 7 or 8 kids that want to be carpenters or constructors, and they couldn't do that without Mr. Perkins, which is another one that's probably going to be cut if there's just no taxes. I'm not in favor of the raising of taxes unless they're for a good cause, and I think this is a good cause to help people, the kids, do what they want in the future. I'm not talking for myself because I'm going to be a freshman next year, but 7th and 6th graders of this year, some of them might want to be a carpenter or a chef or something in that line of work, and if they don't have IA or home ec, they won't be able to get any of these opportunities unless they take a special course in a different school or during the summer. And I looked into them, they're pretty expensive. But there's nothing really that I can say about myself, because my parents are taxpayers, and I don't really result from the taxes, except for the cuts in the schools. But I just want to say, you should do what you can to save the different opportunities in the school system for kids that come later on. Thank you.
Very good at what I did, and I lost my job.
and I saw policemen cut, firemen cut, and Massachusetts, I think you know, by the globe, once in a while, it's a mess. I may have saved a few hundred dollars in my taxes. I lost my job. And a lot of civil servants lost their jobs, and it's not a nice place to be. They can't handle the crime. I mean, you want the real world? The real world now is kids on drugs. It's a total lack of jobs in this country. They require anything, you know, low-skill jobs, let's say. You know, we don't have the factories anymore. Where are kids going to go if they're not trained? You want the real world? What about the homeless? Do you think a lot of those people just don't want to work? There's no work. We're in a situation right now where the whole country is changing. The world's changing rapidly every single day. We've got to keep up. I've been on a fixed income for 9 years. I'm trying to raise two kids on my husband's salary. And every now and then we straighten out and somebody goes through a pair of shoes. You know, it's not easy. I'm terrified of taxes going up. But the reality is, they're going to go up. There's nothing you can do about that. I hate to see the schools cut because children are the future. I know this. As an educator, as a parent, I know this. And when you cut schools, you start cutting civil jobs, you don't go back. Once you make those cuts, they never cut the meat, by the way. They never cut the fat, right? They always cut the meat, always. When they say this, don't be fooled by this. Nobody wants taxes to go up. My parents are retired. I know how tough it is. It is tough raising kids and paying higher taxes. You're going to pay them one way or the other. One way or the other. And please, let's spend the money wisely. Keep it in our schools. Keep it in our civil workers. Don't cut in the wrong way or you'll never go back to the way it was. We need the future, and the future is our children.
To begin with, I would like to say that I sympathize with those people who are living on fixed income. However, I think sympathy is also deserved for the students of this school, which are now facing a lower quality of schooling than that of which they faced when they entered into the school system. I find it to be very sad when students of this school system are facing losing valuable programs, programs which we need and want very badly. In reality, which so many people have come up here and spoken of, school system needs money. In reality, the children of this school are the future of this community. And in reality, if we don't get the money, the future of the school and the community will be directly affected. Now, some say that our demands are too high and are unwarranted, but they aren't demands, they're needs. This school needs the things which we are asking for. We cannot afford to have any more cuts in the school system. These are valuable programs. Now, I've heard some people come up here and speak of the problem of putting their children through college. The education which we are getting now is giving us an advantage. Although college is a very high rate, if we get a quality education and have access to the extracurricular activities which we now have, we have a better opportunity and advantage to get into a college. Other people have come up here and spoken of the problem. Other people have spoken of problems considering teachers, for one thing. And I think teachers in the school do deserve the rewards of career ladder. I don't think that they are overpaid, for they are directly responsible for the future of this community. They directly affect the students of this school. The students of this school are very important, and the teachers deserve the reward of career ladder. I also hear, as a student, see many cuts which alarm me. I recently approached a teacher and said, I'm very interested, I think I'm going to be taking one of your specialized science courses. And he told me to take it soon, because he said that he wasn't sure if it was going to be there for me in the next year. He told me to take it my junior year and not to put it off to my senior year, because he honestly felt that it might not be there. Now that scares me. I feel that these programs are warranted and needed. And on behalf of the school body and the student body, I plead with you not to cut any further. Thank you very much.
My name is Dick DePerry. I've been fortunate. I've had five kids go through the Cape school system. It's an excellent school system. I'd like to suggest that it was an excellent school system before we had such large increases in the budget. Basically, I looked at the Cape newspaper here and I saw that some prefer a tax hike. It looked like that I was going to be all alone tonight and trying to talk to the council. Kind of urge them to remember that there are senior citizens in this town, and there are people on fixed incomes, and even the people that are working. I don't know how many people got a 10% raise last year, but not many problem. What I'd like to do is to urge the town council to hold the line, to keep the budget down, and primarily not because I want to see programs cut. And when you look at this thing, they always seem to cut the emotional stuff, and they seem to cut things that nobody wants to see cut. But I'd like to see some pressure put on the school committee to go back and look at the compensation system and to look at the thing that seems to have driven our school budget so high. And, you know, put everything in balance. And when you do, I think maybe we can avoid these rather large increases that some of us can avoid. Thank you.
The council has a senior citizen who resigned from there.
Anybody else?
Yes.
I have a question before I say anything. My name is Sally Barker, and I really am new to this. Why I'm asking these questions, but I scribbled this down fast. If you're with me, it sounds like we really need to reconsider where we cut. I think we all—it's obvious that we need to cut taxes, but not at the expense of our children's education or the police force or the older citizens. I mean, I'm going to be there too. My parents are getting ready to retire. I'm sure nobody wants to, you know, make people feel uncomfortable. And I know a lot of us are on fixed incomes, and mine's not fixed where I want it to be. I mean, it's tough. You know, I think another thing that is to be said is that a lot of you people were talking, I do sympathize with you, but when you were working, you were making a lot more money than we're ever going to make because of this economy. Now you're struggling, you have to cut back because you're retired, and you're having to live like where a lot of us have to and we'll never get beyond. So that's just another thing to think about. And my main concern is the size and location of the kindergarten classes, which I've spoken the past two board meetings about. I really hope we can protect them as they form their first precious impressions and attitudes towards school. The IA and home ec, I didn't know anything about it. I don't have any kids in school yet, but boy, that sounds scary cutting into that stuff. That's definitely cutting into the meat, not the fat. If we don't rush this, that's what my question is. If we don't rush this, can we have time to carefully reconsider where we're making our cuts? Can we have board and public discussions so that we can toss out ideas on other places to cut instead of maybe this isn't possible, maybe this isn't, I'm not political at all, I don't know. But it seems fair. It seems like maybe we should try to, you know, meet a common ground for everyone. Thanks.
Sure is that when the taxes are cut, it's the other person's program that gets cut and not their own. No one wants to give up a federal pension. No one wants to give up a federal grant of any kind. But they want the other people to give up something. I think that the first priority of local government in America is education, public education. With all due respect to what Judy Potter said, I would be very much opposed to an assessment of any kind because that undermines the most fundamental tenet of self-government, local self-government in this country, and that is, again, public education. There is, with all due respect to everybody that has some interest in a service provided by local government, there is nothing that compares to the objectives of public education. It is true that the Cape Elizabeth school budget has increased over the years. I've heard people come up here and talk about how long they've lived in the town and what's happened to the school budget over that period of time. Now, this may come as a surprise to some of you, but I have spent 52 out of my 54 years in this town, since 1938. I went to these schools, and they were far different than they are now. Far different. There was no police department then, Vaughn. No police department at all in Cape Elizabeth. There was no full-time fire chief in Cape Elizabeth. There was, I'm sorry to say, Michael, no town manager. No tax assessor. But there were school teachers. There were school teachers. So that said something about the priorities of the town then. And it said something about what the role of local government was then. First and foremost, public education. Now, I'm going to pay a pretty good increase if this budget goes through. Thank you very much, Jerry. I'm not particularly happy about it. And I think the members of the school board over here will tell you that there are some programs that I don't particularly care for. And I would have hoped that they would be cut out. But they're not, and I'm not making that decision. But I will tell you what I feel very strongly about in that budget, and that is teachers. Somebody talked about the honeypot, I think it was you, Vaughn. I do want there to be a honeypot for teachers here. Now that is heresy to a lot of people. Don't get mad at me. Don't get mad at me. I want to explain this. If a school teacher has an opportunity to teach in Los Angeles, to teach in Jacksonville, to teach in Winnetka, Illinois, or Newton, Massachusetts, or Portland, Maine, and all those places want that school teacher, I want that school teacher too. I want to be able to compete for the very best school teachers. Most of this budget is in personnel. That's the case with most budgets. And those are the people that really make the difference. You can have all the programs you want, and again, I have a problem with program-type education. But what really counts is the interaction between a good school teacher and a student. It makes all the difference in the world. And I want to be able to attract the very best. And I want to attract the very best, not just while my children are around, but so long as I live in this community. Because the mark of this community, what it really stands for, and how well we perform as citizens, is represented in the kind of education we provide to young people. Not our own children, but our community.
Grades 4 or 5 are now part of the elementary school instead of the middle school program.
And so you see a large cut in the middle school, and you see a large increase in the elementary school.
Anybody else?
Bill, just one more thing. I want to set the record straight when I got up to speak. I maybe look like a senior citizen. I am still gainfully employed. I still work 6 days a week. Thank God I could pay my taxes, and I will pay my taxes. I've been a resident of Cape Elizabeth for over 30 years, but my concern is not for myself. My concern is seeing this community fast approaching a one-class society, and I have terrible fears about this, because then truly we are not giving our children the benefit of a well-balanced education to face their life on the outside.
Therefore,
I'll
close the public school municipal budget. I hope you all know wrong because I'm going to stay here, but the council has asked me if we couldn't have a 5 minute break so you can get up and stretch, and we'll be back here in 5 minutes. And we'll pick up the item as far as the budget goes. Thank you. How's the other two? Please check. Is that all right? We have all our troops here now, so I will move on to item 175, to consider the adoption of the fiscal year 1991 general fund budget, take any necessary action.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Cottershaw.
Be it ordered the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, having held a public hearing on May 14, 1990, upon the proposed fiscal year 1991 municipal budget, does hereby finally adopt the municipal budget for the Town Council for the town of Cape Elizabeth for the fiscal year 1991, with gross expenditures of $13,692,201 and gross resources of $4,585,487, the amount of $9,106,714 to be raised by taxation, and is further fixed Wednesday, October 3rd, 1990, and Friday, May 3rd, 1991, as the dates upon each of which one half of such taxes due and payable, with interest to accrue upon taxes due and paid after each such date at the rate of 12% per annum.
You have a second?
Second.
Any member of the council have a comment?
Chair.
Councilor Cruz.
I guess I would say, begin by saying, I guess this defines the hot seat. Here we are. I have some observations to make on this agenda item, though, before I get too far into the actual discussion of the monetary items. And the first thing that I want to do is thank all of you for coming out tonight, and sincerely thank all of you for the calls, the cards, the letters. I've been very popular the last 3 weeks, and I really enjoy it. But seriously, thank you for caring enough to take the time out of your busy schedules to care enough about your town and about your schools. I think it's extremely exciting to see this type of citizen participation. The second thing that I ask of you, though, is don't let it stop here. You've also got to take this political action that you have, that you've been working with over the last month, take this energy that's in this room tonight to your county officials that just raised your taxes almost 40% in 1 year, to your state representatives that have the power to do income tax and the power to do state tax, to your federal officials, and tell them that the property tax is just about tapped out. We can only get so many services out of this property tax. We've just about at our limit now, and we need help from other levels of government. Some of us have been fighting this fight for the last 2 years in Augusta, in Washington, in different areas, and I hope that you all can take this political action and continue to move it as we begin to see the roots of some of these problems, which is that you can just get so much out of property taxes. And I think that's one of the big lessons that we can learn here. Now I want to make some more specific comments regarding some of your letters, some of your comments, and some of the very insightful things that have been said over the last 2 hours, and I've never been more impressed with a public hearing in my life. First is that, again, this is now coming from my perspective because we've finally reached the point where it's time for the councilors to let their views be known. First is the idea that this has something to do with monetary cuts. We've heard a lot about that term, monetary cuts. But to me, what this is really about is massive increases or even more massive increases. Some of our neighbors to the south in Massachusetts or in New Hampshire, for those of you who've been following the papers, have really had to do the gritty, gritty work of keeping their budgets at the same level as last year or lowering them from that level. Those are significant cuts. That's an incredibly difficult situation to be in, and fortunately, we're not in that situation. The second is that somehow, if we don't increase all the way to the level recommended by the school committee, that we will suddenly have a less than adequate school system. As a matter of fact, one letter that I received that was sent home to some of the parents inferred that even with minimal cuts, somehow we would have, and I quote, a mere skeleton of an educational system, or, and I quote again, our school system will crumble. Well, I'm here to report some very happy news then, I guess, to the citizens of Cape Elizabeth, because it's my belief that we have an excellent school system, and that we're going to continue to have an excellent school system. It's going to get better because of this budget. And why? For three reasons in my mind. First of all, the teachers are getting a significant increase, and to me, the teachers are the engine that drives this entire system. They're getting a significant salary increase as our way of saying, yes, you are the shining stars, you are the light, you are the center of our school system. And we applaud you and we want to reward you appropriately. There's no question about that. There's also a net increase in the number of teachers in this budget. And third and importantly, let's not forget that the town council tonight will pass a bond, last year passed a bond, putting over $1 million into the physical plan of our school system. We can't forget that. A $1 million commitment that we're making for the physical plan. So we're trying to help improve the personnel, we're trying to help improve the physical plan. I think we've got a great educational system, and I think we're building on it. And the third thing that I just want to react to is another term that we've all heard a lot over the last month, which is that some would rather raise taxes than reduce school services. Well, let me say clearly that we are going to raise taxes. We're going to raise them significantly, and we're going to raise them this evening. The question in my mind is, what are we going to do with all that extra money? That's a lot of extra money. And what are we going to be doing with it all? It's been suggested that we can't go below a 10.8% increase in this town. But I did a little research to confirm something that was lingering in the back of my mind. And that was that at a 9.0% increase, or a 9.9% increase, either one of those represents the largest tax increase in the history of Cape Elizabeth, and the largest expenditure increase on the school department side in the history of Cape Elizabeth. So now let me put my hat on as a taxpayer for a minute and say to you, the largest tax increase in the history of Cape Elizabeth isn't enough. If that's true, then I say that there's something that's wrong with a much deeper root than we're addressing here tonight. And I certainly hope that we can all continue to work together as citizens to get at that deeper root. So for me, a 10.8% tax increase is simply unacceptable. because it places too much pain onto those that can least afford it. And I don't just mean the elderly on fixed income. I mean the married couple, the working couple, trying to get by in a region of the country that is experiencing an economic downturn. We've gone to great debates on this council, for those of you who've followed us over the last few years, on how do we keep Cape Elizabeth affordable so that many of us can continue to live here, and importantly, so that the next generation that's coming through can continue to live here. Well, I suggest to all of you that by increasing our taxes almost 11%, that's not moving in the right direction. That's not helping us make this town a more affordable place to live. So I just wrap up my comments and the observations that I've been wanting to make to you people because of all the response that I've gotten by saying that I hope we have a good discussion tonight, and at the end, I hope that we come together behind this one town concept, because we can't let it be school board versus town council, old versus young, or any one group against another group. What we have to do is find a way to work together to find this very delicate balance and make this an even better place to live. So, Mr. Chairman, I thank you for this time.
Thanks. Councilor Emerald.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. First of all, I'd like to compliment all the people who are here tonight. And Frank Potenzo said earlier in the evening that he's come to a lot of meetings, and the school board and the town council are always treating each other like ladies and gentlemen. And I think everybody who was here tonight acted like a lady and a gentleman, and particularly very impressed by the students who spoke. And I think no matter what comes of this budget debate tonight, I think we'll all continue to act like ladies and gentlemen, because that's the way this town is. It is a friendly town. And I think we're all trying to come to grips with a really difficult decision this year, because as someone said earlier, there are no villains here in this process. We're all trying to do what we each individually think is the best for this town. I want to compliment the school board on the hard work they put in, how carefully they did listen to everybody's input, and I think the town council has done the same thing. I agree with a lot of the comments where people said that quality education is not an issue here. We all support quality education. The issue is, how much can we afford? And beyond that, the issues that are really important to me beyond quality education, which is my number one priority, but I'm really concerned about diversity in the community, and several people spoke to that tonight. I am concerned about what I see as the beginning of some divisiveness in the community. And I personally feel it's very important that we nip that before it grows. And because of that, I think that it would be an excellent gesture and a very important signal to send out to the town that we do not support double-digit increases in this town. So with that, I'm not going to vote in support of the motion as passed, but at some later time, well, depending on what happens, would like to propose that we go to a 9.9% budget, which I know is just barely under 10%, but it is saying to the people in this town that, yes, we support education, we support it strongly, but we really want everybody who's living here to be able to continue living here, and that we can't support these kind of increases if we want to maintain diversity in the town and if we want to avoid the divisiveness that other communities have had to deal with.
Thank you. Who's next? Anybody else? Councilor Cremer.
I think when I think about last year's meeting, similar to tonight's, many of you remember last year's meeting, Henry Adams was the only person at Town Hall when we had our final deliberations. I guess we've come a long way in the last year, and it's for me, it's been personally a very personally painful process. I, for my own reasons, have felt because of much of the literature that my children have brought home that I've been the villain, that over and over again I have seen indications that the town councilors are the ones responsible for cutting home economics and cutting industrial arts. And I've been very defensive on the phone, both on the phone and in person, with individuals over this particular issue, as I have tried to convey that it is not my decision what to cut. It is not the town council's decision as to what to cut. We simply try in some way, looking at all of the numbers and all of the members of both the school and the town side, we try to get some kind of equality. So there isn't jealousy, and there isn't that kind of something that can grow in a community and really divide a community. I don't know why it is we struggled so hard to keep salary raises in the 5% ballpark on the municipal side, and why we have instructed our town manager to work very hard with regard to the negotiation process with the police department. When I see at least proposed 7% increases to the administration and the school department, if my numbers are correct, it seems that somewhere in a ballpark of $10,000 is there. I don't tell the school board what to do. That's not my job. The issue of the portable classrooms this year, I felt that by voting for the portable classrooms, we really eliminated the need to chop up the current areas of home economics and industrial arts for new classroom space. I supported it and I continue to support it.